doesn't love Wahoo? I mean, let's start there. Baby, that's it. That's the bomb diggity bomb right there when it comes to offshore pelagic game fish. Wahoo is super, super special, right? Dolphin are great. Sailfish are great. We all love to catch all of that, but there's just something really special about Wahoo. Everybody goes nuts over Wahoo, and for good reason. First of all, it's a really, really powerful fish. They're super fast. By show of hands, how fast can a Wahoo swim? 60 miles an hour, okay? Keep in mind that it's not in a marathon. It's more of a sprint, okay? A short little burst, 60-mile-an-hour burst. They're not going to swim 60 miles an hour from here to North Carolina. That's not going to happen. That's why you hook one of these fish, they smoke the reel, dump half the reel, and then they fizzle out because they just exerted all of their energy or most of their energy. But just the fact that they have the capability to swim 60 miles an hour is extraordinary. It really is. So they're super fast. And that plays a big role in how you target Wahoo. Number two, it's a very fast growing fish, up to 20 pounds in 1 year. Okay, there was a fish that was 11 pounds that was tagged 12 months later was 33 pounds. Okay, so that's over 20 pounds in a 12-month period. Now, not every year is that fish going to grow 20 pounds, but if it's in the right environment, plenty of forage, you know, and if all the conditions are right, that fish can really grow fast, very much like a dolphin. Okay, dolphin, you know, obviously it's not a dolphin seminar, but dolphin can grow 20 pounds in a year. Okay, same thing with the Wahoo. Very, very fast, grows very fast. Delicious on the dinner table, right? One of the best eating fish. When it comes to sashimi and sushi, nothing beats raw Wahoo. Far better than even tuna. Okay, my favorite way to eat Wahoo is raw. Okay, so it's really a great fish on the dinner table, which is why it's so prized also. And it's prestigious. It's beautiful. They get big. You know, and speaking of big, how big? Anybody know what the largest Wahoo ever caught is? They've been recorded up to 185 pounds. 185 pounds, which, by the way, I weigh more than 185 pounds, but that fish right there is about 50, okay? So imagine more than three times that size. That's a Godzilla of a Wahoo, okay? Absolutely enormous. Now, of course, they're not all that big. The average size fish, 25 to 35 pounds, 40 pounds, 50 pounds. Certainly, you'll see 60s, you'll see 70s. Over in the Bahamas, you'll see triple-digit fish. Rarely will you see a 100-pounder along our coast here, but they are caught, okay? But certainly every year, you'll see some 60s, you'll see some 70s, and maybe even a fish in the 80s. So, you know, again, really, really big, really fast, highly coveted, beautiful. When I moved down to Florida long ago, and I would go out there and do everything that I can do to catch them, and guess what? Guess what I caught? No Wahoo. I caught dolphin, I caught sailfish, I caught everything, and I just couldn't catch those damn things, and I was getting really mad. Everybody out, not everybody, but, you know, I'm watching them being caught, and I just wasn't dialed in. So I made a commitment to really get dialed in and to target this one fish, okay? And I bring that up because this is really important for this seminar. We're talking about Wahoo fishing. We're talking about high-speed fishing for one species. My goal is not to go out there and load up on dolphin and maybe catch a Wahoo. I'm not going kite fishing for sailfish and maybe catch a Wahoo, because you will. You can go out there and troll planers for king mackerel and catch a Wahoo, am I right? Okay, as incidental bycatch. That's probably 90% of all of the Wahoo that are not caught intentionally. They're not caught by people that wake up and say, I'm going Wahoo fishing today. Me, on the other hand, when I go Wahoo fishing, I'm going Wahoo fishing. I don't want to catch any of those other species, because if I did, I would do something different. If I wanted to go sail fishing, I would go kite fishing and specifically fish for sailfish. If I wanted to go dolphin fishing, I would run offshore potentially and troll for dolphin. Okay, and while doing that, yeah, I may catch a Wahoo, but I'm really targeting other species. When I go Wahoo fishing, I wake up early in the morning, I'm going high-speed trolling for Wahoo. One reason that I'm doing that is because, again, I don't want all of that bycatch. If I'm spending my entire day or my entire morning unhooking bonitas and blackfin tunas and fighting sailfish and all that good stuff, I don't have time to catch a Wahoo because I'm too busy doing everything else. So again, I'm very, very targeted, and that's what we're going to talk about here. There's a nickname for Wahoo, the cheetah of the sea. Okay, and there's a couple of reasons. You know, when I first heard that, the cheetah of the sea, I said, well, it's obvious. The pattern, right? Look at the stripes. Kind of looks like, you know, a wild cat or whatever. That has nothing to do with it. Okay, nothing to do with it. A Wahoo is like a cheetah, and you have to really think about this. This is a apex predator. Okay, it's smart. It doesn't hunt recklessly. It really pays close attention to where it is, what it's doing, what's around it, the conditions need to be right. And very much like a cheetah, it has a select hunting ground. Okay, it knows where it's going to feed. You know, one of the most important things to remember about Wahoo fishing, if you believe that those fish are going to be in that particular area, either because you've caught them there before, all of the conditions are right, and maybe you have a 10-mile stretch, and just for the sake of argument, we'll call it Hillsboro Inlet right here. Who fishes out of Hillsboro? Okay, obviously a lot of us, all the way on up to, you know, I don't even want to say Boynton, that's more than 10 miles, but say north of Boca, hypothetically. That stretch, I've caught more Wahoo in that stretch than anywhere else along the entire East Coast here. I know they're there. I know they hunt there. I know it for a fact. So where am I going to fish? I'm going to fish right there. And as long as the conditions are right, I'm going to continue to fish, and I am going to pound that entire area until I catch them. You know why? Because Wahoo are very picky. These fish are not stupid. Big fish don't get big by being dumb. Okay? They don't eat 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They don't do it. Okay? They're selective on what they eat. And oftentimes, they're there, and they'll see your lures come flying by, and they'll just go, ooh, ooh, okay? And as the morning progresses, slowly they'll raise higher and higher in the water column, and then boom, you'll get a bite. Don't think that fish wasn't there the whole time, okay? He very likely was in that area the whole time, but like you and I, we don't eat 24/7, am I right? Okay, when you're ready, you eat. Very much the same with a Wahoo. When you're ready, you eat. Okay, so they're there. So again, have extreme confidence in the area that you're fishing. When I said earlier, if the conditions are there, if I go into my, you know, we'll call it kill zone, my kill box, where I know these fish are there, where I've caught 90% of my Wahoo in this 10-mile stretch, but there's green water, really, really green, like what we call kingfish green water, pea soup, you know what? I'm not going to fish for Wahoo right there, because I know that that's not the ideal scenario to catch that fish. That is a pelagic predator that likes nice, clean, blue water. It also likes current, moving water. Why? Because when the water is moving, a lot of different things are happening. You know, a lot of different things are happening. When the water is still, the last couple of days here, I know a couple guys that went out, were drifting with live bait, and their boat was sitting in one spot going like this. And in 2 hours, they told me they moved 50 feet. That's not really the ideal scenario to catch Wahoo, okay? Especially realizing this is not a schooling fish. This is not a fish like dolphin that you're gonna find in huge packs. Usually, there are more than one Wahoo in an area because the forage is there, the food, the conditions are right. So if everything is right for him to be there, then guess what? His girlfriend's gonna be there too. Or whatever it is, there's going to be generally more fish in that specific area. Sometimes you will find loosely scattered packs of Wahoo. Offshore, you find a pallet. Sometimes there's half a dozen Wahoo in the same area. But generally, it's a solitary hunter. When I go out here and I say, hey, I'm going high-speed trolling for Wahoo, I'm looking for one. Anything above one, gravy. Just a bonus. Okay, it really is, but I'm just looking for that one. So I realize the target species. I realize the characteristics of the fish that I'm going after. And you have to too, because in order to be an effective Wahoo fisherman or an effective any kind of fisherman, you have to know your target. You have to know what that fish likes to do and where it likes to hunt and how it hunts and how it lives. A lot of what we're going to be talking about is going to be focused on this particular area, but same tactics apply over in the Bahamas as well, okay, with a couple of different twists. So let's start first with the boat. Anybody can go out there on any kind of boat and go Wahoo fishing, okay? People have caught them on kayaks, on all kinds of stuff. But of course, that doesn't make sense for high-speed trolling. For high-speed trolling, a kayak certainly isn't going to work. Center consoles, of course, the most popular. Sport fish boats. The ticket is you're moving fast. Why are you moving fast? Because we've got to cover a lot of ground. That guy is not just sitting there like a mutton snapper on a wreck. Okay, he's not sitting there like a grouper under a ledge. He's on the move. He's on the hunt. He's fast. He's powerful. He's got a fork-like tail, and he's moving. And if I'm looking for that one fish, I want to cover as much ground as I could possibly cover. So while I can troll slower, okay, and I can troll at, I don't know, 6 to 9 knots and pull ballyhoo and all kinds of stuff like that, strip baits, and it'll work. I'll catch these fish, but I'm also going to catch all that other stuff. If I'm specifically looking for that wahoo, I got to be on the move, and I got to be moving fast. Fast, what is that? The definition of high-speed trolling, in my opinion, nothing slower than 12 to 14 knots. Okay, nothing slower and as fast as 20 knots. You are not going to outrun that fish. He can move 60 miles an hour. You're not trolling at 60 miles an hour, are you? The magic number that I have found has been 14 to 15. The calmer that it is, the faster you can troll. The rougher that it is, the slower you're going to troll. Does that make sense? Okay. As long as your lures are staying in the water, because unlike marlin fishing and dolphin fishing, where you want your lures, what we call breathe, where you want them to come up on the surface and gulp a little bit of air, smoke comes out behind them, that bubble trail. That's not what we want when we're wahoo fishing. We want our lures to swim parallel right under the surface and to just fly right through the water. I don't want them to skip. I don't want them to jump. I want them to stay submerged the entire time. If I look back in my trolling spread and I see my lures are up on top, what does that mean? I'm going too fast. I've got to slow down. Or my lures might possibly be too close to the boat. Okay, so we're going to talk about the spread in detail as well. This is not simple fishing. Well, I mean, it's simple fishing and it's easy, but it's very detail-oriented. Very detail-oriented. Why? Because if you're out there trolling at 15 knots and you're pulling a really heavy sinker and a big heavy lure and a 60-pound wahoo at 60 miles an hour crushes that bait, any weak link that you have between that lure and this reel will be exploited and you will lose that fish. I promise you. Okay? I promise you. And not only will you lose that fish, you're going to lose how much? $60 to $100 worth in tackle, maybe even more. So who doesn't want to lose fish? Okay, none of us do. Where are we going to fish? Let's talk about depth. You can catch wahoo from 75 feet of water to 1,750 feet of water. Okay, this fish will swim everywhere. However, the key zone, the magic number when you're high-speed trolling is really about 100 to 200 feet. If I had to narrow that down even more, I would say 130 to 180. What I like to do is I go out the inlet, I get right in that zone, and I kind of zigzag all the way up the beach or down the beach, wherever I'm going. And I'll work that same area over and over and over because I'm confident he's there, and it's just a matter of time. Wahoo are structure-oriented. Wrecks and reefs. That's why that magic depth of 100 to 200, what do we have right out front here? We have reef lines that parallel the coast. We have a wide array of artificial reefs, wrecks, all the way up and down the line. Okay, the wrecks don't hold a wahoo. The wrecks hold wahoo food. Speedos, goggle eyes, bonitas, juvenile blackfin, okay, small mackerels. That's what the wrecks hold. And guess what he's eating? That. Okay, this is not a fish that prefers to hunt for small little pilchards that are this big. Why? Because the reward is not worth the effort. This fish, imagine, very much like a cheetah. Remember we talked about that earlier. Does a cheetah kill everything that it chases? No. Okay, it has to make that evaluation. It has to say, is this effort going to be worth the reward? And that's what wahoo do, because when they take off, when they see something that they want to eat, a lot of different things happen. Okay, their body clinches up, all of their muscles expand, they take off, they get an extra layer of slime when they take off after a prey item. Why? What does that do? It helps them fly through the water with less restriction. That's why when you catch a wahoo and you gaff them and you throw them in the boat and there's a mess. In the Bahamas, you can go a little bit deeper. Why? Because there's a huge problem in the Bahamas that we don't really have here. Not as bad. Anybody know what that is? Barracuda. Okay. You stay too shallow in the Bahamas and you're dealing with barracudas all day long. So you tend to fish a little bit deeper in the islands than you do here. 90% of the time when you get a bite high-speed trolling out here, it's the right kind, okay? And you know immediately, that reel's going, and you're like, yes! You know, you're totally stoked because it all came together and you got them on. Or if it's a bonita or a kingfish, it's gonna go, and that's gonna be that. And you're gonna be like, oh, that's not him. You know if it's him. Let's talk a little bit about tackle. Remember what I said earlier. There's a lot of different ways to fish for wahoo. And there's a lot of different ways to high-speed troll for wahoo, okay? But what's really important is that you've got some pretty beefy tackle. Why? You know, we're pulling 48-ounce leads, okay? 3 pounds of lead, and that could be a third of the spool behind the boat. And then behind that is a really big lure, like this Chaos high-speed bullet, okay, way back there. Okay, so you've got all of this, plus you have a big shock leader. You know, you need some serious tackle. Is this overkill? You know what, I'll tell you this. You can be kite fishing. You know, we've been kite fishing with 20-pound outfits, and you get a wahoo to eat your kite bait, and you catch them, no problem at all. Stationary boat, you've got 500 yards of line on your reel, perfect outfit for fighting a wahoo standing up while you're kite fishing. Not a big deal at all. Not in this scenario. In this scenario, you really need some beefy tackle. Reels, 50 wides are really what I feel is the perfect size reel. We fish Alutechnos 50 wides, a Tiagra 50 wide. There's a variety of different options out there, international 50 wides, all sorts of different kind of stuff. That's the right size reel as far as I'm concerned. Line, let's talk about that. 3 different options. Wire line, very effective. Very effective. Wire line helps get that bait deeper in the water column. There are still guys that are fishing wire line in tournaments having excellent success. It's a little tricky to work with and you really need to know what you're doing and slightly dangerous. Then you have braid. Okay, braid. We all know that braid has revolutionized fishing. A lot of guys are loading their wahoo reels with 200-pound braid or 150-pound braid. Good option. Then, of course, there's the monofilament, which is what we fish, and I'll explain why. Monofilament is much more forgiving than wire or braid. It has stretch, right? Has stretch. Braid has no stretch. One false move, pop, you're pulling hooks, you're breaking swivels, you're breaking leaders, you're ripping the head off the fish. Not really, but you follow what I'm saying. There's no shock-absorbing factor there. If your drag is off by just a little bit, you know, you really are jeopardizing losing quality fish. So braid is a great option, but you really need to be dialed in. With monofilament, the advantage is you have that stretch, okay? So you've got the forgiveness. If your drag is just a little bit too tight, that's okay, not the end of the world. If your drag's a little too loose, not the end of the world. Another reason that we fish mono is because the truth of the matter is this is my high-speed wahoo rod, but it's also my nighttime swordfish rod, right? So if I had this loaded with just wire, I'm not fishing swordfish with wire line. So in turn, by using mono, you can use obviously that rod for more than just high-speed wahoo fishing. The color of the line you'll see is high-vis, okay? We like the high-vis because you can clearly see it way behind the boat above the surface. It's easy for me to track all of my lures. I can easily see as I'm at the wheel, all I gotta do is look back, I can see exactly where everything is. So I like that high vis color on all of my trolling outfits. Starting strength, 80 pound, okay? You could get away with 50 pound. I don't recommend it when you're high speed trolling because again, you're fishing really heavy leads, big lures. When you're out here high speed trolling for wahoo, the truth of the matter is, and I think everybody here that has experience will agree, you're fishing out of the rod holder. Am I right? Okay, you're fishing out of the rod holder. You're not picking that up and let me reel them in. Okay, or let me hold this under my arm and reel them in. You're not doing that. You're fishing out of the rod holder. It's, you know, meat fishing is really what it is. So don't be afraid to fish that 80 pound. That really is what we found to be the perfect line. Remember that when it comes to high-speed Wahoo fishing, it's a team effort, very much like everything else, you know, with fishing. It's a team effort. And it's really important that whoever's on the wheel pay attention to what he's doing. Whoever's in the cockpit, it's his job to set the spread. It's his job to monitor the drags. It's his job to make sure that everything that's happening is being done properly and effectively. The guy that's at the wheel, it's his job to look at those displays. We use a TZ Touch of Furuno system on our CV, and I'll tell you what, without it, we probably couldn't catch any Wahoo because we need to have a clear understanding of what's happening below the boat and all around us. You could fish when it comes to Wahoo fishing, when it comes to high-speed Wahoo fishing, up to 6 rods. Anybody ever high-speed Wahoo fish with up to 6 lines? Okay, it is not uncommon. It's what they do over in the islands a lot. Here, it can be really complicated. You don't have to fish with 6 lines. You make one wrong move and you just created the biggest tangle you've ever seen in your life. And we're not talking about a simple tangle. We're talking about a mega tangle. Okay, so you definitely, unless you really have the right crew on the boat and everybody is seasoned and experienced, don't fish 6 rods. Ideally, I have found here that a 3-rod spread is perfect. You don't even have to fish 3 rods. You can go out there and fish 1 rod. It only takes 1 right bait in the water to catch a fish, am I right? We use these Chaos Rodzillas. They're rated for 60 to 130 pound line. It's a light rod, but it's super strong. And again, that's super important when it comes to Wahoo fishing. Short butts, you're fishing it right out of the rod holder, okay? However, a long butt would work equally as well. The bent butts keep the angle of the line closer to the water. Why is that important? Remember what I said earlier in the seminar. You want your lure parallel to the surface, right under the water, as straight as possible. That's the ticket. In turn, these bent butt rods keep those lures lower in the water. However, my shotgun, my long bait, way back there, I like to fish a straight butt rod. Why? Because it keeps the line higher over top of these two. And that's really important when it comes to turns, because I don't want to get tangled. Because getting tangled with these is an absolute nightmare. And I'm losing valuable fishing time. We all know that Wahoo bite best when? Morning, 6 to 9. But ideally speaking, you want to have your baits in the water while it's still dark. Don't worry, they can see them. So as that sun is just starting to peek its fiery head over the horizon, I want to be in place, I want to have my baits out there, and I want to be trolling. The earlier, the better. These are really expensive, right? You don't want to lose that over the side. So safety lines are super important. They sell safety lines at wherever, you know, I don't even know if they sell them here, but different tackle shops at about $70 a pop or a set. Go to your local Petco, $3 for a dog leash. Okay, clip it on, clip it to a cleat, done, $3. Let's talk about the spread for a second, okay? The first thing that I'm going to do when I'm setting my spread is I'm going to set my shotgun bait, my long bait. And when I say bait, anytime I refer to bait in this seminar, I'm talking about lures. We do not high-speed troll with natural bait. You can. There are tactics and techniques involved with that. That's not what we do. We fish lures. That lure is moving through the water so fast, the fish doesn't have time to go, is that a real ballyhoo? No, that's a fake ballyhoo. No, that's a real ballyhoo. He doesn't have time to evaluate it. It's instinctive, okay? It's instinctive. He sees it. It's racing away from him. Instantly, he makes a decision. He commits. He believes, I can catch it. I could eat it. I can crush it, okay? And he goes after it. That's what it's about. It's an instinctive strike, okay? Really, really exciting. So a lot of different lures, when it comes to high-speed Wahoo fishing, but they all have something in common for the most part. That is, they're shaped like a bullet, okay? And just as an example, before I even show you all of the lures, I'm just going to show you some different head designs, okay? As you can see, this is a high-speed bullet. Looks like a dart, right? And it races through the water. Obviously, clearly, the skirts are not on here. I'm just showing you the heads. But you can see that that'll race right through the water. And it's missing the eyes on that one. Another bullet, right here. Again, shaped just like a bullet. Okay, races through the water with minimal resistance. This one's made out of lead. Again, shaped like a bullet. So makes pretty, you know, makes a lot of sense because you're moving so fast, you want the lure to just race through. If it has a concave face or a slanted face, what's gonna happen? It's gonna pop. It's gonna come, it's gonna be all over the place and pop up out of the surface. So the idea is that bullet shape. Then there's also lures that are shaped like fish. One of my favorites right here, Yozuri Bonita. If any of you guys have, you know, watched my show over the years or read our magazine, you know that that's one of my favorite Wahoo lures. Why? Because it's so simple to fish. You don't have to fish it with a trolling lead. You don't have to have it in any particular place in the trolling spread. Just get it back there. And I paint all of my Yozuri Bonitas black, all of them. They are available in purple. They come in all different sorts of colors. I go black. Why? Because it creates the biggest silhouette. Okay, it's contrast. That's what it is. It's contrast. The fish looks up at a bright, clear sky, sees a black lure. And what does that resemble? Bonita. What does he love to eat? Bonita. I mean, this isn't rocket science. You know what I mean? It's pretty simple. I'm not going to paint it bright yellow, even though yellow lures work too, but I prefer the dark colors. So when it comes to selecting my lures, when I'm setting my spread on my shotgun bait, this is it right here. Why is this one the furthest away from the boat? Because it's the lightest. If I put this one 100 feet behind a boat, you know what's going to happen? It's going to all over the surface. It's not going to swim right. It just isn't going to work properly. So what I do is I'll fish this one way, way back. But first, I'm going to add my trolling lead. Okay, everybody has seen these. These are trolling leads. Sinker, piece of cable on one side, piece of cable on the other side. Why is there cable on both sides of the sinker? Because Wahoo love trolling leads. They see right here, racing through the water. What does that look like? Looks like a fish. You can't blame them for attacking that. That's why it has cable on both sides, okay? What's also important, you'll notice we paint ours white. We paint our trolling leads white, okay? Why? Because they blend into the white water, and it's even harder for the Wahoo to see. So the combination of painting them white and the cable at both sides is going to prevent that fish from biting that off or from even hitting it. Is it still going to happen? Yes, but you're going to lose a lot less. Can you fish without the cable on both sides? Of course you can. You know, you can, but you're going to learn the lesson the hard way. This is what I fish on my shotgun bait. I fish a 24-ounce trolling lead. Then I've got a shock cord connected to that. That shock cord is approximately 40 feet. You do not want it any longer than 40 feet. Why? Because, again, I'm going to go back to this really important fact. I want that lure to track parallel with the surface. If this shock cord is more than 40 feet, that lure tends to rise. Okay, and in turn, it's not really swimming parallel to the surface. So 35 to 40 feet is fine. Some guys will fish them as short as 25 feet, and that's perfectly fine as well. This is connected to a heavy-duty 300-pound swivel that is crimped to the end of my wind-on leader. Now, keep in mind, as I mentioned, there's a lot of different ways to do this. On top of my 80-pound mono, I have a 25-foot wind-on leader, 250-pound test. And from there, it's crimped to a heavy-duty 300-pound snap swivel. Fish the heaviest swivel that you can. I'm telling you, if you fish a weak swivel, it'll absolutely explode, and you'll lose fish on the bite. So make sure it's at least a 300-pound swivel. So I'm going to open up that swivel. I'm going to put on my trolling lead. Then coming off the opposite end of the trolling lead is a shock cord. And obviously at the end of the shock cord is another snap, and that is going to connect to my lure. That's the system. That's the setup right there for the shotgun bait. And I'm going to let that back way, way back there for a couple of reasons. One, sometimes the fish will get spooked by the boat, so you want a bait that's way back there. Also, when I'm making my turns, that bait's way back there. It's not going to get tangled with my shorter rods. So your furthest bait has the least amount of weight. That's the point that I'm trying to get across to you. Your furthest bait has the least amount of weight. So that's the first one that we're going to put out. Then I'm going to put out my starboard corner right here. And I'm going to put on a heavier lid, 48 ounces, like I showed you here, 48 ounces on my transom baits. Now I'm going to fish 48 ounces on this one, and I'm going to fish 48 ounces on this one. Both of these have the same amount of lead. If you're going to put 32 on this one, put 32 on this one, and you can put 16 on this one. Just make sure that this one is lighter. The furthest has the least amount of lead, and the two corners have the same amount of lead. Guys with me there? On my long bait, I'm going to let that out a third to a half a spool, or I'm going to count the clickers on, and I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, and that might be 30 seconds. On the starboard, or I should say the port transom, okay, I'm going to let that out a third of a spool. This one I let out a quarter of a spool. So now all three baits are staggered. They're staggered. They're in different positions. And now what I can essentially do is go in figure eights. I almost can go in literally a figure eight pattern and never get tangled. That's really cool. Okay, because again, you want to spend as much time with your lures in the strike zone as possible. You don't want to deal with tangles. So it's that simple. The baits have to be staggered. Okay, they cannot be in the same positions. So this one is going to be back, like I said, I might count 15 to 20. And this one, I might count 10 to 15. So I know they're in different positions. When I turn to the left, what happens to this long bait? It sinks, okay? And then when I straighten back out, it'll come back up to the surface and, you know, or toward the surface and race back off, you know? In other words, it'll increase speed. So keep that in mind. Really, really important that you set those baits properly when you're fishing a three-rod spread. If you're fishing a two-rod spread, put them in two different positions. Never put them side by side when you're high-speed trolling. So we're trolling along here, 15 knots, flying up the beach. We've got our spread set with our three rods. Everything's working out perfectly. I see some birds out in the distance. I see some bonitas jumping. I'm excited. I know I'm going to get a bite, or I'm certainly hopeful that I'm going to get a bite. And then I do. You know, and super exciting. The reel just starts screaming, the clicker's screaming. And what do you instinctively, what is the first thing that you want to do? You want to run over and pull the throttle back, right? Oh my God, don't do that. Don't do that. Whatever you do, don't make me a promise. Don't touch the throttle. Okay, everybody say, I'm not going to touch the throttles. One more time, I'm not going to touch the throttles. It's that important, okay? Don't touch the throttle. When you get a fish on, he's on. He's hooked, and we're going to talk more about the lures and the different options in a second, but like, look at this Chaos high-speed bullet. Look at those hooks right there, okay? He's hooked. He's not going anywhere. If you back off on that throttle, you have a great chance of losing that fish right out of the gate. Instead, keep the boat moving forward. If you get a fish on right here, the reel is screaming, the first thing you want to do is run over this rod and start cranking. Run over to this rod, start cranking. Move these other baits. Give them a little bit more action. And sometimes you can turn a single fish into a double. Okay? So turn around and start cranking those other two rods as fast as you can. And remember, we've got an advantage here. You know, the one thing that we didn't talk about with the reels that I think is important, these are two-speed reels. Okay? And that low gear is really nice when you're high-speed Wahoo fishing. Really, really nice when you're pulling this much lead or when you're cranking a big fish in. Do you need it? No, but it's nice to have. If you're going to make a big investment in an offshore 50-wide, you might as well spend a couple extra bucks and go with the two-speed. Keep that in mind. So now we're trolling. We've got that fish on. We ran over to our rod. We're cranking. We're trying to get another one on. You know, and I'm not talking about for 30 seconds, you know, 5 to 8 seconds, 10 seconds at the most. You're not going to get spooled. You got plenty of line on this reel. You're not going to get spooled. Don't worry about that. If after 10 seconds you don't get another one on, now you can go ahead and pull that throttle back, but not into neutral. Do not put the boat in neutral. You have to keep that forward momentum. You have to keep the forward momentum. Everybody follow me there? Do not put boat in neutral from beginning to end. As a matter of fact, you're not even going to put the boat in neutral when the fish is up next to the boat and you're about to gaff it. You always have the boat in gear. If I get a bite on my shorter baits, I don't have to, or for example, this one, I don't have to reel these further lines in. You with me? We're still moving forward. I got a fish on here. These are way back there. Leave them back there. I don't have to reel these in. On the other hand, if I get a bite on this one and these two are shorter, I've got to reel these up. I don't have to. You may or may not, you know, interfere, or these may or may not interfere with your fish. But I remember we said earlier, we're going after one fish, right? And we want to do everything that we can do to get that fish in the boat. Everything that we can do. So in turn, the last thing that I want is that fish to potentially get tangled with these. So I'm going to reel these in if I get a fish on the far bait. If I get a fish on the close, I don't have to reel those in. As soon as you get the fish in the boat, punch the throttles and get back on the troll. These rods are being fished out of the back corners. We know that. This is right off my back corner. Well, the guy with the gaff, if I'm cranking on this fish right here, where's the guy with the gaff? He's behind me. So I'm reeling, the fish is over here, and he's behind me with the gaff. And I'm screaming at him, gaff him, but the fish is way over there. Okay, there's no way for him to get over top of me. So the ideal scenario is you're cranking that fish in, you're cranking him, he's coming up closer to the boat, you're going to take that rod out of the rod holder, and you're going to slide it forward. Okay, and you're gonna move up to another rod holder. So this way the guy with the gaff can get in between you and the fish. That's the whole key. The guy with the gaff needs to be in between you and the fish. Now, depending on how many people you have on your boat, you may have to pull double duty. In other words, you may have to fight the fish, but then remember, we've got this big trolling lead. And when this hits the rod tip, what's gonna happen? You're not reeling that through the rod tip, people, okay? I don't care who you are, you're not reeling that through the rod tip. Just not happening. So at some point, you've got to grab the leader, the shock cord, which is in between this and the actual lure itself, and you need to hand line that fish and what we call wire that fish right to the boat, right to the transom. Could be somebody else that's on the boat doing it, or it could be yourself. If I'm doing it myself, when I get to that trolling lead, I back off on the drag a little bit because I know that that fish could take off again. Very likely it may take off again. So be cautious of that. Also be cautious as to where you're winding that shock cord. You're pulling it in hand over hand. The last thing that you want to do is get this long shock cord tangled around your feet, right? You get this wrapped around your feet and you've got a 50-pound Wahoo on that decides to take off on a last run. He's not going to cut your foot off, but you may lose the fish or just get yourself in a bind. So be very cautious as to where you wind this wind-on leader in. Speaking of these, or I don't want to say wind-on, I'm sorry, of this shock cord. Speaking of the shock cord, again, really heavy-duty swivels, 250 or 300-pound test. That is the right size for the shock cord. 25 to 40 feet long, 250 or 300 pound, with at least a 300 pound snap swivel. Now, some shock cords, you will notice, have two snap swivels because some trolling leads are available, as you can see. Does that have a snap swivel? No. So I've got to snap it to the snap swivel on my rod, but then I just have another loop. Okay, so I have to attach another snap to it. So some shock cords will have a snap at both ends. It's really a matter of preference. Different guys do it different ways. Other shock cords will have, but other ones will just have a snap swivel on one end, okay, because the opposite end of your trolling lead has the other snap swivel. But don't go out there and go, oh, wait a minute, this isn't going to work. You know, I can't snap this to that. So make sure that you're dialed in with all of your equipment before you do that. The boat is still moving forward, and this is also where autopilot. I've got a Furuno, a 711 autopilot on my boat. It's like a third person. Absolutely awesome. Okay, it's like a third person. It really is. If you, you know, I'll tell you what. If you fish without an autopilot, it's because you never had an autopilot. Once you have a Furuno autopilot, you never fish without an autopilot again, okay? Because it is that valuable of a tool, not only in that scenario, but in a lot of other scenarios that we'll talk about in future seminars also. But again, the boat could be an autopilot continuing to move forward. I'm further up on the deck. You've got another crew member with a gaff. Okay, he reaches down, gaffs the fish very carefully and cautiously, lifts it over the rail and into the boat. Why cautiously? Because this guy's got what? Razor sharp teeth. And you do not want to be on the receiving end of those teeth. This fish can bite a 20-pound yellowfin tuna in half. Literally, in one bite, bite in half. How they do it, I have no idea. I mean, think about that, the bone structure in a bonita or in a tuna, and they cut it in half. Literally, just one bite. I'll never forget one day, not to dwell on this, but we're up off Boca kite fishing, got a nice kingfish on. Fish has got to be 30, 35 pounds. Get him up next to the boat. My brother gaffs him, literally has the kingfish by the head on the gaff. Wahoo comes up and in one bite bites half the kingfish off and lifts up the gaff and there's half a kingfish. And I just couldn't believe it. You know, the amount of strength that that jaw has is absolutely incredible. So you've really got to be careful, okay? Take pictures after the fish has calmed down a little bit. And that, of course, is why we fish cable on all of our lures, right? Because if you don't fish cable, you don't want to take a chance with that. You know, with kingfish, it's one thing. They're a dime a dozen, you know, for the most part. With wahoo, not so much. So you really have to fish cable. What size cable do we fish on our lures? Anywhere from 250 to 400-pound multi-strand. 250 to 400-pound multi-strand cable on the lures. Different companies rig them with different, you know, different strength cable, but that's kind of a rule. How much cable do you need on the lures? It really could vary. In this particular case, there's probably about 4 feet of cable on there. Remember what's happening here. You're trolling along at 15 knots. That fish comes up and charges that bait. And a lot of times what a wahoo does when it attacks a prey item, it's not trying to eat it on the first swipe. It's trying to injure it. It's trying to rip its propulsion, its tail off. Because it knows if it rips its tail off, easy peasy, right? So it comes in usually from the side sometimes and attacks that bait to try and literally sever it, to cut it in half to remove its means of propulsion. However, when that fish charges, if it's charging from the back at 40, 50, 60 miles an hour, when he grabs that lure, he's going to push it forward. And if that cable is too short, he could potentially snap right there, right on that shock cord, which is monofilament. 3 to 4 feet. You don't really need much more than that, but 3 to 4 feet is the ideal length for that cable. Now let's talk a little bit more about the lures themselves. There's so many different options. So here's an example, bullet style, big red eyes. I like eyes in my lures. I think that they trigger strikes. This has a double hook rig. You know, here's something similar, but of course a little bit smaller. Red eyes, bullet shape, and a jet head. Little holes right there. That's called the jet head. As this races through the water, water's going in here, creating a smoke trail. And what that does is it gives this bait an even larger profile. It makes this bait look bigger in the water than it really is because you've got more smoke coming off of it. And remember that that wahoo has to make that decision and he's got to say, hey, is it worth it to go attack and eat that bait? Well, the bigger it looks, the more that it's worth it because the bigger the reward is going to be. So jets are really, really effective when it comes to high-speed wahoo trolling. The lead head style, okay, big skirts. Color, who's got a favorite color when it comes to wahoo lures? Purple, purple, black, dark. Why dark? Because what does it simulate? What is it, you know, looks just like bonita. So if you're, you know, if I'm trying to mimic a bonita, what color lure am I going to use? Something that's dark. Orange and black, very effective. Red and black, very effective. Purple and black, pure black, just purple, you know, but mostly darker colors. However, there'll be days when that works, okay? When that right there, when you look and you go, well, that doesn't look like a bonita, and it doesn't, okay? It's just the contrast. That's all that it is. And while I've got this in my hand, you know, there's a lot of different lures out there that have acrylic heads like this one. Okay, you can see this is a chaos bait, has a little abalone shell insert in there, puts out a lot of different color, an acrylic style head. Here's another one. Okay, really, really effective, but remember that these are much lighter than the chrome brass or the lead-headed lures. They're much, much lighter. So what does that mean? I have to fish a heavier trolling lead, right? So I'm not gonna take this lure and put it on a 16 ounce trolling lead. It's too light. I'm gonna put this on a 48 ounce trolling lead. So there's that balance. It's all about balance. It's about paying attention to what you're doing and making sure that that combination of the right lure with the right weight in the right position equals the right bite. One of those factors is off and it's not gonna work properly because these fish are not stupid. So acrylic, you know, getting back to this, can be very effective, but definitely gonna need a little bit more lead. Don't be afraid to pull big baits like that. Both of these are real effective. This has a blunt nose, still bullet shaped, okay, but it has a blunt nose. This is gonna create a lot of drag in the water. You certainly need a heavy duty outfit to pull this type of lure. But because it has a blunt head, it creates a lot of turbulence, a lot of smoke, and that again makes that bait look a lot bigger, okay? But remember, you need a heavy duty outfit for a blunt style head lure like that. The Yuzuri Bonitas we talked about, and here's a absolute staple, an Islander style lure over a skirt or two skirts with a couple of lead sinkers inserted into skirts. I see a couple people shaking their heads. This is a absolute Wahoo killer from coast to coast, everywhere. You absolutely have to have this in your spread. Okay, it's really, really effective. You'll also notice, you see how this trailing hook, how I've trimmed the skirt? You wanna do that, okay? You definitely wanna do that. Trim your skirt so that hook is exposed. Why? Because sometimes these little strands will get caught right on the tip of the hook, all right? Will it prevent a bite? No. Will it, you know, cause you to lose a fish or miss a fish? I don't think so. I think it's more psychological. But do it. You know, if you're gonna do everything right, do it the right way. So try and trim those skirts. His question is, on some lures, the hooks are set in line or sometimes they're opposite. You know, sometimes it's a stiff rig with both hooks in the same position. Sometimes they're in complete 180 degrees. Different companies rig their lures different. Everybody seems to have a different preference. I prefer really a single hook rig, to be honest with you. And if I'm gonna fish a double hook rig, I like this 180 configuration where they're opposite, but there's a problem with this. Even though you may look at it, and just to be clear, let me move this skirt here, okay? Maybe that makes it easier to see. You'll see one hook is this way, one hook is this way. Wahoo comes along, he eats that bait, crushes it, gets this hook in the top, this hook in the bottom. But then, and what is he doing? Essentially ripping the hooks out of his mouth. He's literally ripping the hooks out of his mouth as he's opening, closing his mouth. That's why when you take a lure like this, we'll say this Chaos High Speed Split, you'll see both hooks are in the same position. So they help you hook the fish, but it reduces fish pulling the hook. So again, there's benefits to both. And what I would like to mention to you, there's another little trick. You won't see it on this particular lure, but something that's important. If you're gonna rig your Wahoo, take a crimp and crimp just 3 or 4 inches. Stick a crimp right up there ahead of the lure, right there. So this way that lure cannot slide past that crimp. Why do you wanna do that? Because oftentimes you'll hook a Wahoo and then this will slide all the way up here. And guess what might happen to it? Another fish might come up and attack it and cut you off. We've learned this the hard way. By putting a small little crimp right there, it prevents that from happening. Is it essential? No. Okay, is every time you hook a fish, another one gonna come up and eat the lure? We only wish, right? I mean, we can only wish. But again, it's all in the details. You know, one of the things that we didn't talk a lot about was drag. And I wanna just touch on that real quick. You're pulling these fast lures, you're pulling these heavy weights. So as you're trolling along at 15 knots, if you look down at the reel and it's creeping, see what I mean by it's creeping? Line is coming off like this. Guess what? Your drag's not tight enough, okay? So you wanna just slowly push the lever up. You don't want that line to creep off the reel. So when people say, what is the right drag setting? It varies because it depends. Is it rough? Is it calm? Am I going down sea or am I going up sea? Am I going beam to sea? What size weight am I pulling? How big is the lure that I'm pulling? How fast am I going? You know, literally, there's so many different variables. That's why you constantly have to monitor it. You have to look at the reels and make these fine-tuned adjustments by just simply sliding that lever drag forward or back. I want to bring it back to where no line is coming off the reel, but if I grab the line, it'll come off the reel. Okay, the fish will hook itself. There's so much tension between you and the fish, it's going to hook itself. Okay, so really, really important when it comes to drag setting. Seasons, let's talk about that. 365 days a year, you can catch wahoo. 365 days a year. But they prefer water temperature from about 74 to 80 degrees, which means fall, winter time. Fall, winter time. That's why the bite peaks in the winter time. But you can go out in the middle of the summer. Anybody ever caught a wahoo in the middle of the summer? Come on, yeah, you can do it, okay, because they're here. They still have to eat, all right? But peak season is when that water temperature is a little bit cooler. Let's talk about current, okay, and tides and the moon phase. This is a big one. And they all kind of relate to each other, all right? A lot of guys say, what do you think is the best time to go fish, you know, wahoo? Is it during the full moon? Is it no moon? You know, downside of the moon? What is it? First thing I'm going to tell you is go wahoo fishing when you can go wahoo fishing. That's number one. I'm not one of those guys that's going to look at the moon and go, oh, shit, forget it. I'm not going. All right, I'm just not going to do it. Nah, the moon's not right. Dude, the moon's not right. What if we can't go? Seriously, the moon's not right. Don't do that, okay? Make a mental note. Pay attention to what's going on, okay? But don't fish by the moon. Fish whenever you can fish. However, we've all heard that wahoo fishing is better around the full moon, the week leading up to the full moon and the week after the full moon. And this is why. When you've got a larger moon, it increases the velocity of the current and the tides, right? More pull. The more pull there is, the more bait and forage is spilling over the reef. So the ideal scenario, if you were writing a book or a movie, and you said, what are the absolute perfect conditions for wahoo fishing? It would be a few days before or after the full moon, and the tide, it was high tide at 5 a.m. So I go out here, and it's 6, 7 a.m. It's just the beginning, the first hour or two of the outgoing tide, but it's a strong outgoing tide because of the full moon. So a lot of bait is being spilled off the reef, being pushed out of inlets and being sucked out of inlets. It's almost like somebody's ringing the dinner bell. Where's the wahoo going to be? Right there feeding. That's the ideal scenario. But I promise you, no moon, wrong tide, you're still going to catch wahoo. Okay, you're still going to catch wahoo. But everybody likes that full moon because the conditions are really ideal for catching fish. That's the key. Tide, same thing. You know, I really like an outgoing tide because it flushes all of that forage and stuff off the reef, but I'm perfectly fine with an incoming tide as long as it's moving. That's the key, as long as it's moving. If it's slack tide, what's happening? Nothing. I've also found on overcast days, when you have some haze and it's overcast, sometimes those wahoo will tend to bite later in the day, okay? Then if it's bright blue, sunny skies, they seem to shut off at like 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock at the very latest. Forget it. On a bluebird day when that sun is shining and it's already 110 degrees out there, if you haven't caught a wahoo high-speed trolling by 9 o'clock, go home. Go home or do something else because you're not going to. Okay, it's game over. Stop wasting your time and your fuel. And speaking of fuel, a lot of guys don't like the high-speed wahoo troll because it burns a lot of fuel because you're right at that speed where you're not really up on plane and you're pushing that boat through the water and you tend to burn a lot of fuel. I can tell you my CV, my 37 CV with triple 350s, I burn more fuel at 15, 16 knots than if I was doing 30 knots. So we talked about the moon, We talked about the current and the tide, okay? We talked about water temperature. We talked about where, you know, structure-oriented. I want to just throw a couple other things out there unrelated to high-speed trolling, you know, that'll help you catch more Wahoo when you are doing some other stuff. You go offshore and you find some debris, not your typical everyday weed line. We know what your typical everyday weed line looks like, right? Yes. But you find a pallet, a Cuban raft, who knows? I mean, you'll find all kinds of stuff out there. I found a guy one day floating out there. Okay, I did. Okay, yeah. And it was surrounded by dolphin. It was the craziest thing. Guy fell off a freighter the night before and was floating around all night long. And he had it, you know, they were out there looking for him, not to get too far off the subject. But I see Coast Guard guys, you know, 5 miles away from where we are. And I'm like, oh, they're obviously looking for somebody. It was fairly rough, 3 to 5s. And we're out there trolling for dolphin about 8 miles off, 10 miles off. And one of my guys says, hey, there's that log out there that we passed. And I'm looking up at a frigate, you know, literally just I'm on the wheel. I'm looking up at a frigate and it registers. I said, log. We passed that log. We were like 4 miles off the beach. And I'm like, where? Where's that other log? And I look over and, you know, it was pretty choppy. And I just see. And I'm thinking that's a log, like a branch. And I'm like, it's a guy. You know, I mean, like, you know, you don't expect to see some guy. And it was this little guy from, I don't even, you know, whatever, I don't know what country. And he was wearing a life jacket that was covered in black tar. He was a worker on one of these freighters. And I don't know if he intentionally jumped or fell, but they were looking for him all night long. We found him. I went up and grabbed him, threw him in the boat, and he just went, gone. I thought he died right there. And these two guys are beating up on dolphin. And I'm like, are you crazy? And now, and let me tell you, because they were out there, here comes the Coast Guard, BSO, you know, the Customs and Immigration. I got helicopters, and these guys, and there's dolphins just jumping all around the boat, blood everywhere. Yeah, and I know. I'm like, dude, this isn't right. Something's not right with this. But long story short, we brought him back to port. I don't know eventually whatever even happened to him. So never heard from him. Hoping he's okay nowadays. But anyhow, getting back to it. So you find something floating offshore, and you're catching dolphin on this, you know, pallet or structure, whatever it is. There could very well be Wahoo deeper in the water column. You're not going to see them up on top. A real simple tactic, grab a heavy diamond jig. We talked about this earlier. Drop it down, heavy diamond jig, okay? Drop it down as far as you want to drop it. And when I mean as far, don't just stop at 100 feet. Let it go. Let that baby rip, man. Get it down there 300, 400 feet. Lock it up and just crank like crazy. Crank like crazy as fast as you can to get that jig back up. And oftentimes you'll catch Wahoo really deep. If it doesn't happen one time, try it again. You know, like with everything, listen, even high-speed trolling, if you're not successful the first time you go out and try this, don't give up. You know, don't say, oh, Mike doesn't know what the hell he's talking about, okay? Because I can tell you I'm not successful every time I go out there and do this, you know, especially because you're very limited. You're not going out there for 3 days at a time. You're really only giving it 3 hours, 6 to 9. That's kind of like the magic, you know, magic time. So, you know, get up, go out there early. You're fishing, you know, 6 to 9. You don't, it's only 3 hours. It's not always going to work out. If it doesn't work out, don't give up. You know, think about what happened. Think about what you were doing. Get your tactics dialed in. Make sure everything's right. And when you really have a lot of confidence in what you're doing, because fishing is about confidence, isn't it? If you're out there and if you're looking at your lure, whatever it is, and you're like, gosh, you know, I just don't know. What the hell you think is going to happen? Okay? I mean, I just don't know. On the contrary, I know. I know. I know what eats this. I know. I'm putting this out there. Okay? I've got confidence in this bait. That's what it's about. And it's not only about the lures that you're fishing. It's about the tackle. It's about the technique. It's about all of the little details. Because one wrong move, and you put in all of that time, all of that effort, all of that expense to potentially, you know, come unglued and lose that fish. I've always said I'm a really big stickler about angler failure and tackle failure. 90% of the fish that are lost because of one of those two things, angler failure or tackle failure. By show of hands, nobody just starts spitting this out here. Somebody give me an example of angler failure. Sir. Miss gaff shot. Okay, there you go. Daniel, good answer. Miss gaff shot. You guys got the gaff? He's so excited. There's a 50-pound wahoo right there, and he's trying to stab it. Okay, he's trying to stab it. He's got a gaff that he doesn't even know how to use. Remember, when you're gaffing a fish, and I know this sounds a little silly, but believe it or not, it's not that silly. There's a technique and a tactic as to how you gaff fish. You don't swing out. You sweep in. Does that make sense? You sweep in. You don't sweep out. So you have to pay attention to where that hook is on the end of the gaff and what angle that hook is at. I know it sounds silly, but it's a fundamental that's absolutely important, because you only may get one shot. You only might get one shot at that fish. You mess it up, adios amigos. You're going, damn, man, I should have listened to Mike. I really should have listened to Mike. So that's a perfect example. Somebody else give me another example of angler failure. Put the boat in neutral, 48-ounce lead went thump, the hook went thump, and you just lost your fish. Angler failure. Now somebody give me an example of tackle failure. Frayed line, okay? Frayed line. Anybody ever do this? Oh, yeah, it's a little frayed. No, it'll be fine. It'll be fine. No, it's good. It's good. You know what? I'll change it after the next fish. Right? It's good. I'll change it after the next one. Or you look at a knot and you go, you know, it really doesn't look right. It's good. What do you mean it's good? It's not good. Okay? The line being frayed is not good. You know, you've got to fish. When I go out there, I don't care what I'm fishing for, especially wahoo. I'm praying one day to catch that 80, 90, 100 pounder, so I'm ready for him. And I know that it's in my hands. I may only get one shot at that true trophy, right? Because that doesn't happen every day. That doesn't happen every day, but it happens pretty damn common. But a really, really big one in any species doesn't happen every day. So you've got to really be ready for that one. And you may never even get a shot at that one. That's what's so unfair about fishing, isn't it? But, and then some yo-yo goes out there, goes, oh, look what I caught. And I'm like, well, are you kidding me? You know, but anyhow, you know, you've got to be ready for that one. If anything is wrong, anything, I'm telling you, you're going to lose. You're going to lose. If your line is frayed, you're going to get busted off. If your knot or your crimp is not right, you're going to get busted off. Okay. If your swivel is not strong enough, you're going to lose fish because your swivel went boop and popped open. Okay. There's so many different things. Be a smart fisherman. Don't be a stupid fisherman. You know, there's really no other way to say. Think about what you're doing. Think about everything, all of the little details and how they all work together, okay? And how there's a balance between rod, reel, line, leader, terminal tackle, lures. And remember that rod, especially when you are wahoo fishing, this is really important. Especially, this is like daytime sword fishing. Anybody here ever daytime swordfish? Okay, couple guys. Let me explain something to you about daytime swordfishing that's very similar to high-speed wahoo fishing. When you are fishing with a rod out of a rod holder, and you are not physically fishing like this and in control of everything that's happening with that rod, essentially the boat is fighting the fish. It's all one giant cohesive unit. Everything from the fish all the way to the wheel, to the helm, is one unit, okay? So any move, you know, you're out there daytime sorting or even wahoo fishing, and you get some yo-yo at the wheel, and he punches the throttle, and the rod is in the rod holder, what's going to happen? You're going to pull that hook right out of that fish, because every action has a reaction when it comes to fishing out of a rod holder. So you have to think about it all as one large cohesive unit. And everything that boat is doing is reflected all the way down the line, all the way to the fish. And that's really, really important when you're fishing out of a rod holder, which again, when you're high-speed wahoo fishing, that's what you're primarily doing, okay? You're fishing out of that rod holder. So getting back to a couple more tips for catching wahoo other ways. On the troll, if you're fishing planers, your leader that goes from the planer to the bait, okay, needs to be long. Okay, a lot of guys will go out there and they'll fish a 30 to 50 foot leader, 100 feet from the planer to the bait, 100 feet. That's why you'll see, you know, those yo-yos, those spools that you wrap your leader around, get yourself some of those. Okay, you want 100 foot between the actual bait and the planer itself if you really want to increase your odds with Wahoo. Okay, that long leader certainly can be monofilament, but obviously it's nice to have a little bit of wire right there at your strip bait, at your rig ballyhoo. If you're not going to rig your own baits, you can purchase rig ballyhoo rigged on wire and then just get yourself a lure, you know, an Islander or any type of skirted lure. Of course, here at Chaos, they've got, you know, dozens of them, and just slide it down over top of the ballyhoo. That gives the bait a larger profile, makes it look like a bonita, prevents the bait from washing out. Very, very simple. Snip off a little bit of wire, slide it through, create a little haywire twist and a loop, and boom, you're good to go. It's that simple. This seminar isn't about planer fishing, so we're not going to get into that in great detail, but there are other ways, as I've said over and over, to catch these fish and even to increase your odds. When you're kite fishing, big baits, blue runners, goggle eyes, speedos, if you can get your hands on tinker mackerel, you know, small rainbow runners, don't be afraid to fish big baits. Another thing that a lot of guys do, there's a select crowd out here that you don't hear very much about, okay? And they'll go out and they will have some heavy-duty Wahoo outfits and they will troll for bonitas, little bullet bonita. That's what we call these small little juvenile bonitas or bullets. Or little blackfin tuna, we'll call them bullets. And they will go out and they'll troll these little bullets, which are not very easy to keep alive in a big pen. You would need like a tuna tube. Everybody know what a tuna tube is? So in turn, they catch these bonitas and immediately they bridle them and feed them back out. And they slow troll with bonitas and little blackfin tunas, and they catch Wahoo that way as well. When it comes to chasing Wahoo, 100% blue water. And a lot of times you'll see a distinct color change. You'll see blue-green, and boom, there it is, right down the middle. Stay on the blue side. You want king mackerel? Try the green side. You really want Wahoo? Stay on the blue side. But remember this, that color of that water that you're seeing is only up on the surface. Okay, that green water is not 200 feet deep or 150 feet deep. At some point, it's going to fade into cleaner water. And there's likely, could, you know, very likely be fish below that in the cleaner water. But you don't know that. Okay, I know that they're very likely, more likely to be in that cleaner blue water because not only do they feed on those tuna species and bonitas, but they also eat flying fish. And where are flying fish? Up at the surface, you know, and you're rarely going to see a lot of flying fish in that nasty green water. So always the blue water. So his question is, so when you are fishing a planer, okay, and you have a 100-foot leader, it's going to rise up. Inevitably, you are correct. It is going to rise to some degree, but I'm fishing a heavy bait, not too heavy because it's going to trip the planer. So I'm fishing a large double, usually a double rig ballyhoo with an Islander style lure on top of that ballyhoo. You could also do that with a strip bait. We have found that it's always going to be more effective to have that longer leader. Are you going to get some rise? Absolutely. I don't care how long, you know, you can be at 30 feet and it's still not going to be parallel to the planer. But the longer leader is going to get you more Wahoo bites and it's going to get you more kingfish bites. You know, it's going to get you more bites in general. So keep that in mind. Remember that planers, you'll see number sixes, number eights, and you'll see the plate size. A planer is not rated by the plate size. Don't make that mistake. You can have the same plate in a number six or a number eight planer. It's rated by the weight size. So depending on your tackle, some guys can pull number eight planers because they have the right equipment, heavier rods, you control them a little bit faster. Other guys can only fish number six planers or even number three or four. The key is getting that bait below the surface. Remember, they're related to mackerels, they're related to tuna. Bright light is not something that they love, on the contrary. So the ticket is getting that bait lower in the water column. Also remember that in the summertime, that water temperature is warmer up toward the surface, right? So the deeper it is, the cooler it is. Another reason you want that bait deeper in the water column. Location out here, really very simple. From Miami to Palm Beach, 100 to 200 feet of water. Are there some areas where they're concentrated where it's better? Up off Boynton Beach seems to be a really hot spot for Wahoo. Up off Palm Beach, they catch a lot of them. right outside here, we catch a lot of them as well. But you got to put in the time. A lot of times the charter boats will catch a lot of them, and you'll read all of these local charter boats catching Wahoo, but that's because these guys are out here 24/7. They're out here every single day, two trips a day. And remember what I said at the beginning, the Wahoo could very well be there, just not eating. We talked about reels, 50 wides, don't do it with anything less than that. 80 wides is a little excessive. So again, I really find that 50 wide to be the perfect size. The Chaos rods, Rodzilla 60 to 130, perfect size rod. The line, 80 pound high vis. Wind on leader is completely up to you. Make sure your shock cord that we talked about, 25 to 40 feet, 250 or 300 pound test, pretty simple. And remember, all of this stuff that we're talking about is gonna be up on that website. You will get a link to it where you'll be able to just push one button and boom, there's everything Mike's talking about. Has anybody ever used downriggers instead of, say, planers? And you certainly can. The problem is with downriggers, you're limited to speed. At the very most, you know, 8 knots, somewhere in that ballpark, maybe 10 at the very most. You know, we're talking about trolling at 15, 16 knots. That's fast. That's almost 20 miles an hour. And you're going to have too much blowback with a downrigger. That's what we call that, blowback. So it's not the ideal tool for this particular scenario. It's a great tool for targeting Wahoo at slower speeds, but not an ideal tool at these speeds, okay? Remember, you know, let me just finish this off, and I'll address some more questions as well. I can't stress enough, you know, if I want you to leave here with anything, I want you to just really remember how important all of the fundamentals are, you know, and all of the little details. You know, I talk to so many different fishermen, and there's some guys that, you know, they're out there in these $7 million beautiful custom sport fishing boats, and they know everything about everything. Okay, you can't tell these guys anything. And, you know, that may be true, I don't know. And then you have what I call the everyday angler, guys like you and I who put on our pants one leg at a time, who want to make the most out of each and every trip, right? You know, I want to go out there. Fishing to me, is it about catching? Of course it is, but it's about so much more. It's about going out, doing the very best that I can in every way possible, knowing that the outcome may or may not, you know, be positive, but at least I'm going to walk away from it and I'm going to say, you know, I did the right thing. I did the right thing in the right place, the right way, and I increased my odds for success. And whatever happens from that point is out of my control, because there are certain things that are in my control, and then there are certain things that are out of my control. Avoid the angler failure. Remember, we talked about that earlier. Take your time. Don't make silly mistakes. Don't go, oh, man, if I would have just took that shot with that gaff when I could have, we may have had him. Instead, he's swimming away. Avoid the tackle failure with the frayed line and the drag isn't set properly. I mean, how bad would that really stink that you put in all this time and effort and you go out there and you don't even have your drag set properly? If you're not sure about anything, especially those fundamentals, get those dialed in. If you don't know how to make a crimp, if you don't know how to crimp a connection before you go out there and go Wahoo fishing, you better learn how to crimp a connection. Am I right? Because you can't do this until you do this. Otherwise, you will lose. You're gonna lose. You're gonna go out there, you're gonna get frustrated, you're gonna lose fish, you're gonna lose tackle, you'll never go again. And then if you have your wife and the kids on the boat, you suck, okay? All right, you went from hero to zero, or you're just zero and will never be a hero, okay? So keep that in mind. So I'm gonna leave you with that. I really appreciate everybody coming tonight, okay? I'm gonna hang around for a little while. If you have any questions, let me know.